crow in the streets is only the most extreme expression of doubt and debate about the future role of West Germany in Europe and the world. The radical left wing in Nuremberg greet their country's chancellor and finance minister with a cry, Kiesinger and Strauss, fascists, out. Chancellor Kiesinger and Franz Josef Strauss represent a group which has governed Germany for 20 years. They represent the conservative, Christian, capitalist virtues. Those virtues now face their sharpest challenge.
Weil wir, auch das muss einmal gesagt sein dürfen, weil wir ihn lieben.
A few yards from where he sits, Chancellor Kiesinger's Nazi party number decorates an effigy in straw. His party will be less easily devoured. But Franz Josef Strauss is the man who dominates the governing party and the election, the kingmaker who may one day be king. He is the most explosive, perhaps the most talented politician in Europe. Although the students offer the Nazi salute as he speaks, Franz Josef Strauss was not a Nazi.
In der Gestaltung unseres nationalen Schicksals am besten sicherstellen kann.
But what disturbs many reasonable Germans about Herr Strauss as their country grows stronger is that the finance minister represents an aggressive spirit in the land, a dynamic, restless Germany. His speeches convey an earthy, hard, real politic view of the world and Germany's place in it. His view increasingly dominates the Chancellor's view. He speaks for 2, sometimes 3 hours. Neither he nor his followers seem to tire. In his peroration, he makes an impassioned appeal for the freedom of Germany and a united Europe.
Kampfes um die Freiheit von ganz Deutschland im Hinblick auf ein freies und großes Europa gehen wir mit einer guten Bilanz nach hinten, mit Mut nach vorwärts, mit Dank gegenüber unserem Volke in diese Wahlauseinandersetzung. Das Wort haben Sie, Herr Bundeskanzler.
The ideas of this energetic, intellectual extrovert are at the center of most arguments in the elections and in German life. He is deeply adored and deeply hated. The response to Herr Strauss is as immoderate as his opinions sometimes are. He is a man who matters to all of us. The radical left hates him. He has raised the temperature, lowered the tone of the election by saying the extremists are outside the law.
Do you think that you, as the press is saying, contributed to the violence of the election by calling the extremists or saying they were like animals? Do you think that you're partly responsible?
Oh, I was referring to certain actions done by the extremists where they behaved that way. I did not call them animals and I did not ask them to be treated as animals. But if people behave as they did, then we are used to be very outspoken.
Yeah. But do you think this election is disappointingly violent? I mean, are you a bit distressed about it? All the shouting that's going on.
If I remember 53, 57, the fools are always the same. Mm. And there is a periodical return of those methods.
I asked Willy Brandt, the foreign secretary in the last coalition government and socialist candidate for the chancellorship, and Herr Strauss's main opponent, what he thought of Strauss's language, why the election was so acrimonious.
I'm afraid that a certain nervousness with my colleagues, the other party, as a result of their feeling of perhaps losing a bit of the position they've had up to now.
It is a sort of desperation, in a way.
Well, yes. Desperation perhaps is going too far, but it is nervousness. Mm.
Yes, what is your opinion of Herr Strauss?
He's a very able man, but I strongly disagree with him in many fields.
Is he a more old-fashioned kind of German politician?
He's everything. He's everything.
Bavaria, the land of the enchanted castles of the mad King Ludwig, Wagner's patron, is also the kingdom of Franz Joseph Strauss. If its architecture, its mountains, its people have a common characteristic, it is excess. From spring to autumn, Bavaria has an air of almost permanent festival. More, it seems, for the benefit of themselves than for tourists. I've never seen any part of Europe with more bands, more feasts, more holidays than Bavaria. They seldom hibernate from gaiety. No people drink more beer. Franz Joseph Strauss is their man. He is the chairman of the Christian Social Union, the Bavarian wing of the Christian Democrat Party. This fireman's ball lasted the whole weekend. The clear mountain air, making inescapable the blasts of the Napoleonic cannon. Franz Joseph Strauss's Bavarian house has on the left his Kaiser Brewery, in the middle, one of the most perfect Baroque churches in Europe, and on the right, the place where he lives with his wife and three young children. I went to see him there. Herr Strauss was a member of the German army that occupied Poland and the Ukraine. He was a prisoner of war in Russia. He has since become rich. His career has been the stormiest in post-war German politics. Mm-hmm. He once lost office over his overbearing behavior.
Your critics would say, or do say of you, that you have been very overbearing, even bullying sometimes in some controversies. I mean, do you see yourself as that? Do you think you were, looking back?
Oh, then I would feel in a good company together with Sir Winston Churchill or Wilson.
Does it worry you? Do you feel sometimes that you have been a little too aggressive in political battles? Or is that part of it, the fun of it for you?
That's a problem of temperament and age. But I think that a politician without ambitions is an automobile without an engine.
When you went into politics, was it because you had a desire for power or to do good, or what was your motive, do you think?
Yeah, in 1945, when I went into politics, there was not much space for desire of power. But I come from a conservative Catholic family, which was very strong anti-Hitler minded. And in the 30s, it was more or less my determination, if the Third Reich comes to an end, to contribute what I could do, that never again we might undergo a similar fate.
Franz Joseph Strauss was born in Munich in the Schillerstrasse. His father was a butcher. Like most German families in the 20s, he suffered the poverty of world inflation. Around the corner lived Adolf Hitler. The streets were rowdy with beer hall Nazis in Strauss's childhood. Hitler's newspaper was published a few yards away from Herr Strauss's father's shop. The Schillerstrasse is more prosperous now, and Herr Strauss has shared in that prosperity by buying real estate in the city. Looking back over the violence of modern Germany, I asked him if he hesitated about going into politics, since leaders might have to declare war to order the shooting of people.
I hate the application of forcible means in order to enforce political goals. That is true in the field of foreign policy, and that is, of course, true in the field of home policy. But if the freedom of my country would be at stake, or if democracy and democratic conditions would be at stake, a responsible democratic politician must be mentally and physically prepared to use power in order to maintain his country as a free country and in order to maintain security and order, and not to leave political power to fools, demagogues, or criminals. We talked about my youth. If the Weimar Republic would have fought against right and against left with more energy, I think in millions and millions of human beings would still be alive, and millions of tragedies could have been spared.
The modern German army was built up by Herr Strauss. It's a conscript army, the soldiers serving for 18 months. Over the past centuries, the army has dominated the state in Germany. It now mirrors the strains and discontents of that state. Many young Germans will have nothing to do with so powerful a symbol of the past. In the last 5 years, the number of conscientious objectors has increased sixfold. Releases on the grounds of homosexuality also increased steadily. Within the army, there are many who would like to see conscription abandoned and the army become professional again. And so the new army sings the NATO song with all the appearance of conviction and harmony. Chancellor Kiesinger has said, echoing Hitler, that the army is the school of the nation. If so, it has some reluctant pupils. I discussed the German dilemma with the great novelist Heinrich Boll, a Catholic. He fought throughout the war as a private. He finds the traditional institutions unchanged.
Well, is German society then very sort of petrified, very fixed because of this?
It became very petrified in the last, I would say, 8-10 years. After the war, there was a change, but this change didn't hold. And there are new classes to come and already there.
Well, so it's, does it then become a very fixed, hierarchical kind of
yes,
society?
Yes, in a way. It's very difficult to see it. If you have a look at German society superficially, you wouldn't see it. But if you penetrate, you find this hierarchical classes very easily.
Well, what is the result of this sort of hierarchical? Does it make a society... I mean, people always used to say that the Germans were authoritarian, they liked authority. I mean,
yes, they do, they did, and they do. Maybe this change would need about another generation. Mm.
What are the forces in Germany that preserve the hierarchy? Is it the church or what?
In a way, the churches, they have a hierarchical class system, and I think they like society to be the same way because it backs them.
In Bavaria, in Herr Strauss's country, it's the land which is the main source of power. In the 30s, farmers were glorified as the purest and best of Germans, spoiled, indulged in creating an Aryan mythology. The farms are small. They're heavily subsidized. Although there are some amalgamations now, the small farmers retain a formidable political power. Their children may have to leave for Munich or Nuremberg, but they are a source of strength for the conservative elements in German life. At lunch, I asked them if Herr Strauss, their hero, was a characteristic Bavarian, how they would describe a Bavarian.
All the characteristics of a typical Bavarian, he is a little more a choleric man, like others, and he knows how to use his elbows, and, well, he likes a good living, too.
But are they a little rough, are they?
They are a little rough. You can say so.
Ein Mensch, der die Wahrheit sagt, der bewusst nicht lügt, sondern irgendwie...
We went on to talk about Franz Joseph Strauss, and I said that elsewhere in Germany, I'd heard people say he was a dangerous man. Why did people say that?
Oh, yes, I know it. I mean, in my opinion, it is a problem of democracy. If you want that democracy runs, you must have people who run all the state and everything. And if these are persons, powerful persons and so on, then people say they are not good Democrats. Look at, for instance, de Gaulle or Mr. Churchill or so. That's the same problem all over the world, not only a problem of Franz Josef Strauss.
How are you going to persuade people, do you think, who are still afraid of Germany, that United Europe isn't going to be something where Germany is the main dynamic power, and so raise people's fears again?
I am glad to answer such a better question. Because immediately after war, when we had to build up from scratch, and when we had nearly nothing, no political influence, no economic power, and of course no military importance whatsoever, and when we made our confession for Europe, we got the reply, of course, you Germans have no choice. Your only choice is Europe. And if you want to get rid of your past, now you must plead fervently for a united Europe. For us, it is much more difficult because we didn't lose the war and we have more choices. Now, when we have built up a modern economy, a powerful economy, when we have again a certain limited political influence and also a small military importance, now we are told you are much too strong to build a united Europe with you. How should Germany look like? Should it be absolutely weak and helpless? Then nobody wants to make a combination with us. And if we have built up a normal state, then say, you are too strong. I cannot do it with you, I think.
The shouts and ghosts of the past haunt the new Germany. Workers try to break up a meeting of the neo-Nazi NPD party, a party that stands for extreme nationalism, for the old frontiers of Hitler's Third Reich. The NPD leader was not himself a Nazi, but his policies, when they can be heard, demand back territories now in Poland and Czechoslovakia. It's a policy that frightens many Germans, as much as it does their neighbors. Workers and students let von Tatten know this, but the NPD is unlikely to win more than 5% of the vote. But that would give them representation in Parliament, a troubling prospect for Germany.
Die oder neiße Linie anerkennen wollen. Und sagte, die SPD lehne es ab.
Schweine! Was? Hier sind die Leiche waren! Komm her, Schweine! Wir wollen wieder!
In city after city in these elections, chiefs of police have banned NPD meetings out of fear of violence by demonstrators and by strong-arm stewards. Invariably, the few permitted meetings end in uproar and the arrival of the police, could become expert at the ritual. Putting a stop to extreme expressions of nationalism does not, though, prevent the growth of nationalist ideas and feeling. By keeping the neo-Nazis relatively quiet, other parties on the right, respectable right-wing leaders like Franz Josef Strauss, can attract nationalist votes by making a milder nationalism. Strauss's view of Germany's role is one of the causes of dissent among the young. Would you buy a used car from this man? Asked the anti-Strauss poster. Many other of the revolutionary students' slogans and ideas are borrowed from other countries, a part of an international revolutionary fervor, although the German police are usually tougher than many with demonstrators. Donald Duck has been elected and erected as principal at the Munich Art School since the students took it over. Their motives are little different from those of students in London, except that in Germany, the students seem to have more reason to complain. In Germany, you find far, far fewer working-class children at university than in Britain. Since the university system is so antiquated and the power of the professors unique, the students have more demands. And being art students, are able to express them graphically. The presence of ex-Nazis on the staff exacerbates tempers. Some German writers claim that the German educational system is now perhaps the worst in Europe. It's not a view that Herr Strauss shares.
I hate all those exaggerations. I remember the same kind of fools who told German education is above everything. Deutschland, Deutschland über alles. The whole world can profit from the superior German genius and nonsense, all nonsense of that kind. And it is the same kind of nonsense to say now the German education is reversed. That is just a prefabricated opinion, and it is exercised with the intolerance of religious wars.
What is your view of the German educational system?
I have the impression, and I think it's still a system of privilege. It's very hard to get education in Germany, and for the working class, almost impossible.
So I noticed that of the people at universities or places of higher education, it's only just over 5% are the children who work. Why is that?
I don't know. People just don't make use of the possibility to get education. And I think they are frightened or afraid of the gap becoming between them and the children after education. Because educated academic people in Germany are very highly estimated. Mm. And they feel very highly, too.
But they're very proud of themselves.
Yes. And they have a sort of arrogance to the not educated, which makes it very difficult.
Discontent is growing in Germany. After the war, housing, like education, had to take a second place in the struggle to recreate the German economy. A defeated people were grateful for anywhere to live. Materials and energy were directed mainly elsewhere. For two decades, the nation dedicated itself to exports and more exports. Trade was master, and the test of success was profit. The workers were rebuilding their lives by rebuilding industry. Although their share of the national profit diminished, their wages steadily increased. The German worker was held up as a paragon of industrial behavior. The question is, why have they been so docile for so long?
I think in the whole, they're just tired. You know, if you look back at the 19th century, where the German working class was the most progressive in Europe in a way, and it was up to 1933, they were betrayed too often in history. In 1918, betrayed of the revolution. In 1933, betrayed by the nobility and the bourgeois milieu. And I think betrayed too after 1945.
German workers' complaints about lack of opportunities are common to many countries. Germany's wealth gives them extra force.
Ah, prices. You earn good money today, and it's worth nothing tomorrow.
The wages are not enough, the rents are very high. Prices are always rising, and what a husband earns by himself is not enough.
We need workers' control to see that the national income is properly divided, so we don't have a situation where minority makes millions in profit and the workers' share has gone down. There are still many people earning less than the subsistence level, less than 12 pounds a week. Not that anybody in Bonn cares.
Davon nehmen aber die Herren in Bonn leider keine Notiz.
Not one single party, not one at all cares about us.
The traditional workers' party, the Social Democrats, is led by Willy Brandt. Since for 3 years he has been foreign secretary in the coalition government, he and colleagues like Dr. Schiller have gained a new authority. Willy Brandt could be the next chancellor. But if the socialist leaders have gained an authority, they have lost some respect on the left, who feel they acquiesce too readily in assuming that what mattered more was the creation of wealth rather than its distribution. A new left-wing party, the RDF, may take socialist votes from Willy Brandt.
Do you feel yourself, looking back over the post-war period, that the workers got a fair share of the economic recovery in wages, in education, particularly in education?
No, of course not. But I think we, by now, have created some of the conditions in order to raise the problem of not only wage increases, but some of the reforms which go beyond that and which really deal with the workers and other groups' position within society. And as you say, especially in the educational field, we have a great deal to do in order to bring about equal chances.
Yes. One gets the impression that society is perhaps a little petrified or immobile. There hasn't been enough movement between or upwards in the society. Would you agree with that? I mean, would you like to see that different?
Yes, this I think is the main thing beyond all the day-to-day quarrels. The problem is how to come closer to a modern Germany, how to speed up those reforms which are necessary not only in the economy but for science, public health, transport, renewal of cities, and especially sufficient good possibilities for education.
Social Democrats may wish to revalue the Deutschmark in the interest of their neighbors' economies and their own workers' standard of life. But for the middle class of Dusseldorf, Finance Minister Franz Josef Strauss is correct in believing that the present Deutschmark is a source of comfort, strength, and a good life. For many, Strauss's financial policies seem a chauvinistic Deutschmark über alles. But here on the Rhine, they seem a realistic use of German strength. Among the industrial rich, Strauss's support is firm as among the farmers of Bavaria. The guests at this lunch party included leading figures in the iron and steel and motor car industries. It's been 20 years of Christian Democrat taxation and investment policy which contributed to their great wealth. Did they think that Franz Josef Strauss could lead that party and become chancellor?
I think it's possible. I know that he has not only friends, and sometimes he has made mistakes. But he's a very temperamental man, and every temperamental man makes mistakes sometimes, and I prefer temperament to a quiet sort of personality who makes no mistakes because it does nothing at all.
Yeah. What is your view of Franz Josef Strauss?
I would agree with what he said. Any activity creates contradictions, that we prefer the activity than the passive attitude. Isn't that so?
Yes.
Thank you. But even among the industrial middle class, opinion is divided about Herr Strauss's economic nationalism. Usually the difference is one of age, and there are over 2 million new voters. It may be a sign of Germany's strength that its national policies exhibit profound conflict. The policies of weak countries are seldom worth argument. Thus, Herr Strauss personifies the arguments about economic policy and about the division of Germany. One young man found him dangerous.
I don't think that he's really a Democrat. Perhaps he's good in being popular with the German people, because Germans still today like authoritarian people. But I don't think that this kind of personality is good for a democratic country.
As Germans, do you ever feel that the other people in Europe and the world are afraid of you?
Yes, very much so, because I traveled quite a lot to other countries, and I found it terribly difficult to travel on a German passport. At my point of view, mostly, because we are considered to be brutal, cruel, and dangerous to our neighbors. We are considered to be, in a way, uneducated, which means marching into other countries and taking into our control other people's property.
You think that's not a fair picture?
No, I don't think so. Not at all. I think we have learned quite a lesson, and I think that the youth, or let's say the younger generation, which means the generation which was born just before the war, or during the war, or after the war, does not represent this mentality of Germans, which might have been true before.
What do you think of some German politicians who argue that Germany should be reunited, that there should be the old German state?
Well, I don't think I think like them. I don't see any advantage, real advantage, for European policies in a unification. I think it's better things stay as they are, with some modification.
But do you don't feel you have a sort of sense of nationhood in common with Germans in East Germany or in elsewhere?
Yeah, they are Germans, but it doesn't mean that we have to belong to the same country. Austrians used to be Germans too, but facts are facts.
These facts are not facts for the majority of Germans. No German politician could come to power by abandoning the East, by permanently recognizing the division of Germany. The debate between Strauss and Brandt is about how to bring about a reconciliation, a debate of profound importance to every European country. Herr Strauss, the most forcible German politician, wants a united Europe with nuclear weapons, a world power on Russia's frontiers. But he may not win.
Herr Strauss, if the socialists, the SPD, were to win the present election, would this mark a very drastic change in German policy at home or abroad?
I would like to say, under a realistic aspect, the socialists have not the slightest chance to get the absolute majority. Therefore, if they would win, and if they would get the relative majority, and if they would make a coalition with the liberals, that would not be of advantage for our country, because, pardon me for expressing my opinion as a leading man of the CDU-CSU, but in both parties are strong illusionary elements, mainly as foreign policy is concerned, as evaluation and assessment of Russian policy is concerned, and the combination of the illusionary elements, I think, would lead Germany into a dangerous way.
Would you think that they would be take a less hard line with Russia, or praise Russian motives differently, or look at Eastern Europe differently?
I am for a sober, realistic, illusionless attitude towards the East. We should be open and prepared for a permanent reconciliation, but we should not be prepared to subdue ourselves under Russian terms, that is, just to accept what Russians say, realities of World War II, because that would perpetuate the division of Europe, and that would perpetuate the Iron Curtain, and that would deprive our eastern neighbors of all hopes. And the day when we discuss those problems, we are close to the first anniversary of the Russian invasion in Prague.
Herr Strauss was saying to me, Herr Brandt, that he thought that you were an illusionist, particularly in your attitude towards Russia. I mean, the implication was that you were perhaps soft on communism. What's your view of that?
Well, I prefer to discuss this at home rather than abroad during these weeks, because elections are going to be held in Germany and not other places. But I think Strauss is completely wrong. Illusions are with those who look back and are longing back to the simple days of the Cold War. And realism is with those who, without illusions, think that it is the only right thing on the background of friendly relations with the West and a solid position within the Western community to do everything possible to reduce tensions and to improve relations with our Eastern neighbors.
I get the impression from the speeches of, and the conversation with Herr Strauss and the Chancellor that they're moving to the right and trying to attract a sort of nationalist feeling, perhaps sometimes even an NPD feeling. Now, is this a danger from your party's point of view?
Yes, it is a danger, not so much from my party's point of view, but from my country's point of view, as I interpret it. The danger is that some of the colleagues of the other big party, especially of the Bavarian wing, the CSU, that they run away step by step from what I thought already was a common foreign policy. It's a position which lies behind that one which we agreed upon in December 1966. So in so far, this election period is rather dangerous. It will take some time to put pieces together again.
But I suppose many people in the East and in the West might think that the permanent division of Germany is a good thing, that the status quo is ideal, and would not see any reason for ever changing it. Now, would that really, in the long run, be an intolerable point of view for Germans?
I think that would not be a good point of view. Because if my memory is correct, for instance, Great Britain went to war 1939 in order to preserve the freedom of Poland. The right of self-determination was the inscription or the ideal for which millions of soldiers had to lose their lives. Is this only valid against Germany?
How would Russia, do you think, regard having a united Europe with nuclear weapons at its frontier?
I think the Russians would not like a united Europe, but they did not ask us whether or not we like a powerful Russia.
You do seem, Herr Strauss, to take a very real politic, a very hard view of world politics.
I would do much if world politics would be determined by other factors. Let me say, by Christian principles, by the law of charity, by cosmopolitan sentiments, and so on. I think that would be a much better world. But world politics is not a playground for wishful dreamers. We should try to improve the world. That means mainly to improve ourselves. But we have to take world as it is, and not as we want it to be.